good morning. Good morning to all of you. This is the first Sunday in December. Amen. Amen. And it's also Advent Sunday. Amen. Advent comes from the Latin word Adventus, means coming, second coming. As we are expecting the arrival of the newborn baby Jesus to come into our life and to be with us in the incarnate flesh, we welcome his presence. Emmanuel. Song says, come let.
Come.
Come let us adore him.
Come let us adore.
Kneel down before him. Worship and adore him.
Worship and adore him.
Oh, it's a real simple song. Come, come. Come, let us adore him. Kneel down before him. Worship and adore him. Worship and adore him. Come on and sing Emmanuel.
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 We give you the glory, Emmanuel.
Emmanuel.
We give you the praise. Yes, we
Emmanuel.
Do.
Emmanuel.
Sing that again. Emmanuel.
Emmanuel.
It means God is with us.
Emmanuel.
We give you the praise. You.
We worship you.
We worship you.
We worship you.
Come on, let's sing that from the top. Can you help us sing? It's a real simple song. Come.
Come.
Come, let us adore him.
Come, let us adore him.
It says, kneel down before him. Oh, we worship the Christ, the King. Worship and adore him. Oh. Come, come let us adore,
come let us adore him,
kneel down before him, we worship and adore him. Now come on, lift your voices right where you are, say Emmanuel,
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 Emmanuel.
Oh come on, lift it up and sing
Emmanuel.
Season, we worship you.
We worship
as we expect your arrival. We worship you.
We worship you.
You're the King of Kings and you're the Lord of Lords.
We worship you.
You're the great I am, Yeshua, Yeshua.
We worship you.
You're Jehovah Jireh. You're our provider.
We worship you.
You're our Prince of Peace. Yes, you are.
We worship
you. Oh. Worship you.
Sisters, as we worship the Lord Jesus Christ this morning, will you bow with me in a moment of prayer? Holy Father, in the darkness of this world, clothe us with your armor and hold us closely in your arms. Holy God, Comforter and Mighty God, let your will be accomplished here, O God, among us, just as it is in the heavenly realms. Lord Jesus, bestow on us wisdom, peace, courage, and strength. Help us to see with your eyes and infuse us with a driven passion to be about your kingdom's work. Encourage our hearts and cause us each and all to be instruments of encouragement. Spirit of God, as we make our journey this day, help us to pour out your love and grace to others. Lord Jesus, we ask that our souls catch the wind of your spirit so that we would take your promises to all the earth. We've come today, God, to worship you in spirit and in truth. Feed us, Lord. Feed us, Lord, until we want no more. In Jesus' name, let the people of God say together, amen.
This is Advent, a time of love, peace, and joy. A time when I should be in the preparation to celebrate the birth of Christ. Here I stay. But my child, oh Lord, help me, my child is in trouble. He has trouble, Lord.
What? Wait a minute. Pray. What's going on? Oh my God.
Oh, my child.
What? Mother, why are you weeping? What's going on?
My son.
What? What? Wait a minute.
He's in trouble.
Oh my God, how so? We haven't heard such news. What are you talking about? What's...
I feel it in here.
Okay.
It's a mother's intuition.
Okay.
My child is in trouble.
Okay.
They're a problem. And whatever the problem is, we need to pray.
Yes, ma'am.
We
yes,
have
ma'am.
Got to pray.
Yes, ma'am.
Oh, yes, we need to pray. And we need to pray that the Father in heaven will open up the windows and pour us out a blessing.
Yes,
Reporting, sir.
Why are you here, soldier?
For playing with a deck of cards in church, sir.
For playing with a deck of cards in church, you had better have a good excuse. Have a seat.
The young soldier had been on a march for about 6 days. Neither Bible nor prayer book did he have. But I hope to satisfy you, sir, with the purity of my intentions. He said, "You see, sir, when I look at the ace, it reminds me there is but one God. The deuce reminds me that the Bible is divided into two parts, the Old and the New Testaments. When I see the tray, I think of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And when I see the four, I think of the four evangelists who practice the gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. When I see the five, it reminds me of the five wise virgins who trimmed their lamps. There were 10 of them. 5 were wise and were saved. 5 were foolish and were shut out. When I see the six, it reminds me that in 6 days, God made this great heaven and earth. When I see the seven, it reminds me that on the seventh day, God rested from his great work and called it holy. When I see the eight, I think of the eight righteous persons God saved when he destroyed this earth. There was Noah, his wife, their sons, and their wives. When I see the nine, I think of the lepers our Savior cleansed, and nine out of the ten did not thank him. When I see the ten, I think of the Ten Commandments God handed down to Moses on a tablet of stone. When I see the king, it reminds me that there is but one king of heaven, God Almighty. When I see the queen, I think of the Blessed Virgin Mary, who is queen of heaven. When I see the jack or knave, that is the devil. When I count the number of spots on a deck of cards, I find 365, the number of days in a year. There are 52 cards, the number of weeks in a year. There are 4 suits, the number of weeks in a month. There are 12 picture cards, the number of months in a year. 13 tricks, the number of weeks in a quarter. So you see, sir, my pack of cards served me as my Bible, my almanac, and prayer book.
Stand up, soldier. I find no fault in your action. You are exonerated of all charges. You are dismissed.
To all of our servicemen in the military, the Army, the Air Force, the Coast Guard, the Marines, and the Navy, we wish you
love,
peace,
and joy.
Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Isaiah, the 40th chapter, verses 1 through 11. Our scripture reading this morning is taken from Isaiah, the 40th chapter, verses 1 through 11. Hear ye the word of God. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and proclaim to her that her hard service has been completed, that her sin has been paid for, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice of one calling, in the wilderness, prepare the way for the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be raised up, every mountain and hill made low. The rough ground shall become level, the rugged places a plain. And the glory of the Lord will be revealed, and all people will see it together. For the mouth of the Lord has spoken. A voice says, cry out. And I said, what shall I cry? All people are like grass, and all their faithfulness is like the flowers of the field. The grass withers and the flowers fall because the breath of the Lord blows on them. Surely the people are grass. The grass withers and the flowers fall, but the word of our God endures forever. You who bring good news to Zion, go up on a high mountain. You who bring good news to Jerusalem, lift up your voice with a shout. Lift it up. Do not be afraid. Say to the towns of Judah, here is your God. See, the sovereign Lord comes with power, and he rules with a mighty arm. See, his reward is with him, and his recompense accompanies him. He tends his flock like a shepherd. He gathers the lambs in his arms and carries them close to his heart. He gently leads those that have young. This is the word of God for the people of God. Amen. My brothers and sisters, on this first Sunday of December and the second Sunday of Advent, we want to wish all of you that are celebrating a birthday in the month of December, happy birthday. If you are celebrating a birthday this month, we want you to know that you are most important to us on this day as we celebrate your birthday during this month. May you have many, many more birthdays. Happy birthday to you. We also want you to know that Deacon Afray Johnson, brother, passed away, Gerald Johnson, and we want to be in prayer with their family. Arrangements are incomplete. We also want you to know that Ebert Henry passed away, and we want to remember their family in prayer as well. As our pastor prepares to come this morning, let us be reminded to offer a prayer on his behalf. Will you bow with me in a time of prayer? Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Mighty God, we pause even now, Lord, to say thank you. We thank you, God, for men and women who make up this congregation, boys and girls, young and old. Lord, we give thanks for all of those who have cast their lots with the Sixth Avenue Baptist Church family. We pray, God, for your strength upon those who are grieving and mourning among us. There are many, O God, and we pray for the Johnson's family, and we pray for the Henry family, that you will encourage their hearts. Lord, be with them. Lord, bring back fond memories and happy times as they think of their loved ones during this sad time. Lord, strengthen them and walk with them, carry them during this time. We pray, God, for those who are sick among us. Lord, all who are weak, Lord, I pray that you would undergird them with your strength and your power, that you will raise them up once again, that they too might be able to testify of your goodness and your grace and mercy. And Lord Jesus, once again, we give thanks for our pastor, and we pray, God, that on this day, that you would once again hide our pastor behind the cross of Calvary and allow him, oh God, to preach an unadulterating and uncompromising word of truth to your people. So God, as our pastor stands before us, Lord, speak a word to each of us. Open our hearts, open our eyes and our ears that we might hear and see you so very clear. In Jesus' name, let the people of God say together, amen.
Hello to my Sixth Avenue Baptist family. I'm here to talk about our school located in Liberia, West Africa. Sixth Avenue has made its mark in Liberia. In 2002, Reverend Eddie Gibson, who's presently pastor of Brewster Road Community Church, invited Sixth Avenue, along with others from the city, to visit his homeland in Liberia, West Africa. He told us while we were there that we were to observe the people and the conditions and come back and make a report to the church. We learned that more than 80% of the people are unable to read. After learning about the literacy rate, under the direction of Reverend Gibson, Sixth Avenue donated $10,000 toward the purchase of 10 acres of land in the capital city of Monrovia. We took pictures of the vacant lot that had nothing on it but grass and weeds. The little girl that's standing next to me in the picture graduated from our school last year, June 2019. Her name is Gift. Gift attended the school from kindergarten through 12th grade. Gift is presently looking for a job, but until she finds a job, she has committed herself to coming back to the school and working with the kindergartners. After the purchase of the land, construction was started at the site. Through generous donations from our church and other churches and individuals, the campus began to take shape. Presently, the campus has four well-made school buildings. Each building is used for classroom instruction. In addition to classrooms, two small rooms are used for the principal and the school registrar. Our school, unlike most schools in Monrovia, have bathrooms with flushing toilets. On one of our return trips, we carried and installed solar panels. With the help of the school staff and others in the community, our deacon here at 6th Avenue, Alfred Morton, installed an electrical room where, and you can see where the solar panels are being installed on top of one of the buildings. Birmingham City Schools had unused dust catching dust in a warehouse. They allowed us to purchase some of the desks at a cost of $5 each. These desks were shipped to Monrovia and placed in the classrooms. Before getting the desks, the children were sitting on a cold concrete floor or stump made from a tree. We actually shipped more than 150 desks on a container. The number one killer in Liberia is drinking water. 6th Avenue, again, along with other donation monies, had a pump dug so that the people at the school, as well as those in the surrounding community, could have clean drinking water. Campus life at the Delano O'Brien School is filled with activities. The students and staff are very grateful for contributions made toward educating them. We returned to Liberia and brought over 400 pillowcase dresses, along with other humanitarian aids. The dresses were made by ladies here at our church, mainly Women on Mission Ministry, as well as other people in Mississippi. We had dresses that were made and sent to us from Mississippi, and people who had donated dresses from other churches. We learned also, while there on one of our visits, from the gynecologist at the only hospital that's there, that many women had come to him with a problem, and they had been diagnosed with uterine fibroids. But the cost of the uterine fibroid surgery is actually more than they could afford. The cost of the surgery is, in fact, $275. After making an appeal to ladies here at our church, donations were made. Through their generosity, we were able to pay for 10 women to have uterine fibroids surgically removed. Rejoice, who is the lady in the wheelchair, had the surgery weeks before we arrived, but was unable to leave the hospital because she had a balance due. The hospital's policy is that if you can't, you cannot leave the hospital until you have paid your bill in full. There was a turnstile that each patient had to go through with a slip saying that my bill has been paid in full. We took Rejoice in her wheelchair. Rejoice walked through that turnstile, and she was able to leave that hospital because of the generosity of the ladies here at this church. 6th Avenue is already in Liberia. We've been there since 2002. And I say this to everyone. Christmas time is upon us, and I know many of you will be buying many wonderful gifts for friends and family and neighbors. Right now, I'm asking you to include in your giving the purchase of a school uniform for a student at the Delano O'Brien School in Liberia. The cost of the uniform is actually $15, but the parents are actually paying $5 themselves toward the cost. And so we're asking you all to give $10 to purchase a uniform. Uniforms help promote academic excellence as well as pride for the school. Many parents are not able to purchase a uniform and will not send their child to school. The literacy rate is extremely high, but because of this school, we have lowered that literacy rate. There are three ways you may give, and each gift is tax deductible. If you're giving by check, make it payable to Brewster Road Community Church and put on your check uniforms. The mailing address is P.O. Box 611-504, Birmingham, Alabama, 35261-1504. If you are giving online, go to www.brccbham.org/online-giving/Liberia Education Fund/Delana West O'Brien School. For those of you who are giving via Cash App, go to $Brewster Road CC. And Brewster is spelled B-R-E-W-S-T-E-R, the word road, and capital C-C. All of that is one word. Again, Sixth Avenue has made a mark in Liberia, West Africa, and we're asking you all to be generous like you have so many times in the past, in that through giving $10, a child will have a uniform and will be able to go to school. Thank you.
Hello, I am Lois Germany, president and founder of the Sixth Avenue Sliders Line Dance Fitness Ministry. I am here today asking our congregation to donate gently used clothes and shoes to give to the Hoover Complex fire victims. Unfortunately, on Thursday morning, 20 apartments were destroyed, leaving the families with only the clothes on their backs. Sixth Avenue is known for being a loving and giving church, and this is an opportunity for us to give to the community and give to the people that are in need. This is the holiday season, and we are in the spirit of giving. So please bring your gently used clean items to the church any day next week, or you can call the Fountain Heights director at area code 205-515-3912. The Sliders Ministry will make certain that the fire victims receive your items. Thank you in advance, and may God bless you real good.
worship Emmanuel. Emmanuel means God with us. And as we're in this Advent season, Adventus means expecting the coming, the arrival of his presence with us, that the newborn child will come and be with us and save us from darkness. And we're in a dark time right now. And we know that that same child that came on earth to dispel sin and to dispel all chaos that was on the earth, according to Genesis, is that same Christ that we can expect today to dispel all fear, all worry, all anguish, to come and to be with us. So right where you are, let's just take a moment just to worship Emmanuel, to know that he's with us. Simple song, as you know, oh, come, let us adore you. Oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore. To worship right where you are. Oh, come, oh, come, let us adore him. Oh, come, let us adore, adore him. That's all right with you. I need you to put your hands together like this. Come. Oh, yeah. Right where you are. Come on and put those hands together. It's all right to move right where you are. Come on, you know. Oh, come on, ye faithful.
Joyful and triumphant. Oh, come ye, oh, come ye to Bethlehem.
Come and behold.
Come and behold him, born the King of Ages.
Come, let us, come on.
Come let us adore him.
Kneel down before him.
Kneel down.
Come, let us appraise him.
Forever.
Come, let us adore him.
Kneel down before him.
Come, let us
appraise
forever.
Oh, come, oh, come, let us adore him, Christ.
The Lord.
The Lord.
Come on and put your hands together like this. Come on, help us sing. Oh, come on. Adore him.
Come, let us adore him.
Kneel down before him.
Kneel down before him.
Come, let us appraise him.
Let us appraise him.
Forever.
Forever.
Come, let us adore him.
Let us adore him.
Kneel down before him.
Kneel down before him.
Come, let us appraise him.
Let us appraise him.
Forever. Let's take it up.
Forever.
Come, let us adore him.
Come, let us adore him.
Kneel down before him.
Kneel down before him.
Come, let us appraise him.
Let us appraise him.
Forever.
Forever.
Come let us adore the Lord.
Kneel down before Him.
Come let us appraise Him.
Forever.
My brothers and sisters, it's good to be with you on this, the Lord's Day. Just a reminder, the 6th Avenue Sliders Line Dance and Fitness Ministry, they're donating clothes and they're collecting clothes for the Hoover Complex fire victims. Approximately 20 apartments were burned on Thursday. And so if you would like to drop your clothes off here at the church, you can do so Monday through Friday from 10 a.m. to 12 noon. And you can drop them off right under the carport where we generally collect our offerings. Mr. Williams and Doug Jones will be there to receive you. So I just want to remind you that if you want to drop the clothes off here at the church, please do so under the carport, and Mr. Ivor Williams and Doug Jones will receive them. You can, however, just go to the Fountain Heights Community Center and drop those clothes off there. Thank you so much for your willingness to support the ministries of this church and to help those in our community who are in need. God bless you. Well, my brothers and sisters, if you would, we're going to take a look today at Mark, the second chapter, Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12. Mark chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, and we're going to walk through this passage of Scripture together. Subject of our sharing this morning... Subject of our sharing this morning is entitled, The Lord Who Lives Among Us. The Lord who lives among us. Let's go to God in prayer. Father God, once again, Lord, we're thankful for this opportunity to gather together as one family, as one body in Christ. We praise your name, Lord. We're thankful for all that you have done for us. We know that everything good and perfect in our lives comes from you, the Father of lights, in whom there is no variation or shadow of turning. And so we give you all the honor and the praise and the glory on this morning. As we open the text, Lord, as we look at the treasure that is found in your words, I pray that you would open our hearts, Lord. I pray that you would teach us. And I pray, Lord, even as Moses ascended on the mountain and he bowed down before you, in like manner, may we bow down before you, Lord, in humility. And we ask that you would speak to us. Speak to us right now. In the name of Jesus, we do pray. Amen. Amen. All right, my brothers and sisters, again, our scripture for the morning is taken from the Gospel according to St. Mark, Mark chapter 2. Verses 1 through 12 from the Word of God. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. Now, did you see that right there? Do you see what the text tells us? The text essentially tells us that Jesus, early on in his ministry, lived in Capernaum. Capernaum, that small town on the northern side of the Sea of Galilee, that's where Jesus lived. He had a home there. Now, whether he owned the home or whether it was his personal home or whether he was living with Simon Peter and Andrew, his brother, we do not know. But this right here lets us know that Jesus lived in a specific place and he lived in the midst of the people. And quite frankly, this right here gives us an idea of what God has had in mind all along. The Bible tells us that God does not necessarily want to live above us, far and remote and unreachable. But the God that we serve wants to live with us. As a matter of fact, if you were to look at Revelation chapter 21, the Bible tells us, it tells us that God will make his dwelling place among the people, and they will be his people, and it says, and God will be with them and be their God. As a matter of fact, if you want to be technical about it, as a precursor to all that we're reading, in the book of Genesis, in Genesis chapter 2 and 3, it lets us know that when God created Adam, he was with Adam. He had fellowship with Adam, right? In Genesis chapter 3, it tells us that he walked with Adam in the cool of the day. So our God is not some God who is remote, some God who wants to be far removed from us, but he is a God who desires to live with us, to be among us, so that he can teach us, so that he can show us the mysteries of the universe around us, so that he can help us, love us, have fellowship with us. That is the kind of God we serve. The Bible right here tells us that Jesus lived in Capernaum. And it says that when the people heard that Jesus had come home, look at verse 2. It says they gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he, Jesus, preached the word to them. I'm here to tell you, Jesus was a preaching somebody, wasn't he? Anytime he got the opportunity, he either preached the word, he taught the word, and he gave them evidence. He demonstrated that the kingdom of God was near. Isn't that something? Now, verse 3 tells us that some men came while he was preaching, bringing to him a paralyzed man carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, it says they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it, and then they lowered the mat that the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, Lord have mercy, he said to the paralyzed man, son, your sins are forgiven. Isn't that something? The text says, when Jesus saw their faith. Now, the question that jumped to my mind was, exactly how was it that Jesus saw their faith? What did they do that enabled Jesus to see their faith? Was it simply because, you know, they climbed up on the roof and then they dug a hole in the roof while he was preaching, while he was speaking to this enormous crowd of people? Was it because he disturbed, they disturbed what Jesus was doing? They broke protocol and they lured this man after they had dug a roof. Dug a hole in the roof above? Was it because they lured this man on the mat in front of Jesus? Is that what made Jesus see their faith? Well, incidentally, before we go any further, let me just say this. The faith that we have is meant to be seen. It's meant to be expressed. Your faith is not something that is meant to be hidden. As a matter of fact, in Hebrews, the 11th chapter, and I'm just telling you this because you already know it, but this is just by way of reminder. In Hebrews, the 11th chapter, it tells us what faith is. It says, now faith is the substance. it is material. It is the substance of things hoped for. Faith is the evidence of things not seen, right? So the substance or the evidence that Jesus saw in these men when they dug a hole in the roof was the fact that, listen, in spite of the crowd, in spite of the fact that they could not get in the house, they did not allow the crowd to be an obstacle, but instead what they did was they would not be denied. They said, we're going to get our friend to Jesus no matter what. They would not take no for an answer. And so they climbed up on the roof. Probably wasn't more than a story high. They climbed up on the roof and they dug the grass and the hay and the mud and the dirt out of the way, all right, and they made a hole, and then they lured their friend on the mat before Jesus. The Bible says, now, when Jesus saw their faith, he was amazed. He said to the paralyzed man, son, your sins are forgiven. Let me tell you something about these men. These men who dug a hole in the roof above Jesus, they disturbed his sermon, right? While he was speaking to the people, they interrupted what was going on. They broke protocol to make sure that they got their friend to Jesus. Now, when they did this, I guarantee you they weren't like, well, we hope this works. We just hope that he might somehow be able to heal our friend. No. When they did that, they were certain. They were certain that Jesus would be able to heal their friend. That's why when Jesus saw their faith, he responded to the paralytic like he did. You know, this story reminds me, and many of you already know this, reminds me of the woman who had an issue of blood in the Bible. You know, the Bible tells us for 12 years she had this issue. And it wasn't as if she did not have initiative. It tells us in Luke, it tells us that she went to the doctors. And instead of becoming better, Bible tells us that she became worse, right? But she heard that Jesus was in the vicinity when she was in the marketplace. And she said to herself, she said, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, she said, I know I will be made whole. Isn't that something? That's what she said within herself. She didn't say, if I get close to him and I touch the hem of his garment, I might possibly be made whole. I'm going to try and see if this works. No. She had absolute faith that if she just touched the edge of Jesus' garment, she would be made whole. Now the Bible tells us that when she tried to do that, there were multitudes of people around Jesus, and they were pressing him and they were thronging him, and everybody was, it was a tight situation. It was a traffic jam full of people. But somehow the scriptures tell us that she pressed, she was determined. She pressed her way forward and she got through the crowd, and she reached out to Jesus. And in my own mind, I imagine that she got to a point where she couldn't touch him. So somehow she got down on her hands and her knees, and she reached out and she grabbed
the hem of his garment. And the Bible says that when she did that, immediately she felt within herself that she had been healed. When she touched Jesus, Jesus stopped. He began to turn around and he looked and he said, "Somebody touched me." It seemed as if the disciples got annoyed with him. They said, "Well, what do you mean someone touched you? You see all these people? Everybody is touching everybody. So how can you say who touched me?" Jesus said, No. I felt power. I felt virtue come out of me." When the woman found out, she came to him trembling and she confessed that she had been the one. And Jesus said to her, "Daughter, your faith, your faith has made you whole." That's what I see in these men this morning. They had absolute faith. They were determined that if they got their friend to Jesus, that he would be healed, that he would be made whole. And so the Bible says in verse 5, it says, when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, he said, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now, in verse 6, now some teachers of the law, it says, they were sitting there and they were thinking to themselves. All right, they were having an internal conversation with themselves. It wasn't something that they articulated, but they were thinking to themselves. They said, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone? Why is he trying to take God's place? Who does he think he is? He is a mere man. How can he forgive sins? Only God can do that." That is what they were now thinking within themselves. They didn't articulate this. They didn't vocalize this. This was what was going on inside of them. And then, of course, verse 8 tells us. It says, immediately Jesus, check this out now, he knew in his spirit, he perceived in his spirit that this was what they were thinking in their hearts. Isn't that something? Now, I know that, you know, this is a Baptist church and our roots are not charismatic. And so there are some things, even though I certainly pray that all of us believe in the gifts of the Holy Spirit that are mentioned in 1 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, and in other places, because that the charismatic movement is not our roots, many of us may not quite understand what some of those gifts in the Bible mean. Well, let me just give you something here. I believe that when Jesus knew what they were thinking, he received, as 1 Corinthians 12 would say, he received a word of knowledge. And a word of knowledge is something that God gives to you that you would not know about someone or something otherwise unless he had dropped that in your spirit. Well, that's what we see right here. We see right here in this text that Jesus had received a word of knowledge. Look at this. They were thinking these things to themselves. They were thinking that he was blaspheming. They were thinking that no one can forgive sins but God alone. But in verse 8, it says, immediately Jesus knew in his spirit, right? He knew it. He received a word of knowledge from the Lord that this was what they were thinking in their hearts. And he said to them, he then vocalized what they were thinking. He said, "Why are you thinking these things, huh? Why are you thinking these things?" In verse 9, he says, "Which is easier, to say to this paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take your mat and walk'? But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." Now, my brothers and sisters, right there, Jesus is telling them who he is, and he uses the phrase Son of Man, which is a messianic title. That is a Christ title, if you will. And these were teachers of the law. They knew exactly what Jesus was saying. He was saying, He was saying, listen, he says, I want you to know the reason I said to this man, your sins are forgiven, is because I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. In other words, I have the authority, right? I have the authority to make things right between God and man. I have the authority to clear the way. I have the authority to take someone's sins out of the equations so that they can be drawn near to God, so that they might be in relationship with him. Now, if we were to go back for a moment, to verse 5, when it says, when Jesus saw their faith, he said to the man, son, your sins are forgiven. Why do you think Jesus said that? I don't necessarily believe that the man was paralyzed because he had sinned, but Jesus was always someone who spoke to what was going on inside of the person. He had that word of knowledge that the Spirit gave to him. And so he spoke to this man. He said to him, son, your sins are forgiven. My brothers and sisters, I believe Jesus said that. And right now, I'm just going to throw this out there. It's somewhat speculation because we don't know how or why this man was paralyzed. But perhaps this man had done something. Perhaps he had done something in his life. Perhaps he had sinned against God. Perhaps he had done something that he knew was wrong and he felt ostracized from the Lord. And then perhaps shortly thereafter, he had an injury. He had a fall and he was paralyzed. And he may have thought that his paralysis was punishment for something he had done. So when his friends brought him to Jesus, Jesus picked up on this. And when he saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, he said, son, your sins are forgiven. Can you imagine a man who had wanted to hear this for so long? Can you imagine the weight and the burden that was lifted from this man when Jesus said to him, son, don't you worry about it. I'm here to let you know that God has forgiven you, that your sin is no longer an obstacle. Put that thing behind you. Don't worry about it. Now, I believe that if Jesus did not have to deal with his adversaries, it's possible that on his own initiative, the man could have gotten up right then and there. So Jesus now, he said to the teachers of the law, he said, which is easier to say to this paralyzed man, your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up, take your mat and walk? He says, but I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins. So he said to the man, I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home. Lord have him. In verse 12, look at this, my people. Look at this. The man, he got up. He took his mat, and he walked out in full view of them all. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, we have never seen anything like this. I'm here to tell you, on that day, Jesus, he lit the place up. Can you imagine? Can you imagine this paralyzed man right there on the floor? Everybody is a witness to what is going on. And Jesus tells him, I say to you, get up, take your mat, and go home. And the man gets up in full view of them all. They said, they praised God, and they said, we have never, ever seen anything like this. I'm here to tell you that Jesus lit the place up. Everybody, I bet you there was a lot of shouting, a lot of praising, a lot of jumping up and down, a lot of dancing, a lot of crying. They said, we have never seen anything like this. Let me see if I can bring this home to you. Can you imagine? Can you imagine in this crowd that quite a few people knew who the man was? Can you imagine? Perhaps his mother was there. Perhaps his father was there. Perhaps his sisters and his cousins His co-workers were there. And can you imagine that man who had been paralyzed get up in front of them all? I'm here to tell you, they had a Holy Ghost time right there in Jesus' house in Capernaum. There was some dancing. There was some shouting. I'm sure that's it. Praise God, from whom all blessings flow. We have never seen anything like this. My brothers and sisters. Oh, sometimes I could have wished that I would have been there. Now, what do you think this text is saying to us? This passage of scripture basically says to us that our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives on the inside of us through his Spirit, he has made us right with God. That's right. Whether it's sin or whether it's sickness, all of these things at their root come from the enemy, and Jesus has come to drive all of those things out. Whether it's in our behavior, whether it's in our thought pattern, whatever it might be, our rebelliousness, whether sickness, whether it's disease, infirmity, pain, or whatever, when Jesus arrives on the scene, he demonstrates what the kingdom of God is all about. And so, through the Spirit that lives in us, Jesus has made us right with God. That means that our sins have been forgiven. Son, daughter, your sins have been forgiven. Do you hear what I'm saying to you? Your sins have been forgiven. So let that weight, let that burden be lifted right now. Let it be lifted from your body, be lifted from your soul and your spirit. He, the Lord Jesus, has taken the weight or the burden of your guilt and your shame, and he has nailed it to the cross. And not only has he made us right with God, but he has the power to apply what he did on the cross to our bodies as well. That means that sickness, disease, infirmities, pain, those things have been nailed to the cross by Jesus himself, by his stripes, by the blows that were embedded in his back. The Bible says we were healed, right? So now when you look at the scriptures, Jesus gives life to dead things, right? He has come that we might have life and have it more abundantly. Jesus is someone who gives life to dead things, whether that be a paralyzed body, a paralyzed soul, a paralyzed spirit. In the kingdom of God, right, all of those things are healed. They are made whole, right? Perhaps you know of someone who's had a life situation that has paralyzed them, a life situation that has injured them to the point where they have been incapacitated. Perhaps it has happened to you. But the Lord's word to us this morning is that Jesus wants to make us whole. You know, when you look at this text, it's good to be able to go to the Lord yourself. But sometimes, my brothers and sisters, sometimes it's even better to have friends who will stand alongside of you, friends who will pray with you, friends who are there to keep you encouraged, friends who will support you in those moments. Sometimes when we grow weak, it is good to have friends, right? What kind of friend are you? What kind of friend are you? Are you the kind like these men who hoisted their friend up on this mat, and they went through a lot of trouble, but they made sure that they got their friend to Jesus? Are you that kind of friend? You know what Jesus said about friends, about having people around us? Jesus said, when two or three are gathered together in my name, he said, I am in the midst of them. He also said, when two or three ask anything they want for in my name, if they agree, he said, it will be done for them. Can't you see this in our text this morning? Can't you just see what I said in our text? These men who were carrying their friend, they were in agreement. And because they were in agreement and because they were determined to help their friend was healed. Now, as we try to apply this text today, the difference is today we can't physically take people to Jesus. We can't physically take people to Jesus, but we can bring Jesus to them. We can bring Jesus to them. Why? Because the kingdom of God is within us. Perhaps we can, when we change the way we think in that regard, right? When we go to people on behalf of the Lord Jesus who lives in us, that's what I'm trying to say. When we take Jesus to the broken, all right, to the hurting, to those who have been disenfranchised, this Jesus who lives in us and among us, if we go to these people and we take Jesus to them in the same spirit of faith that these men in our text did, or the woman who had the issue of blood did, if we take Jesus to people in that same spirit, then we will find that with Jesus in our midst, living in us through his spirit, we will find, like what we see in our text this morning, that with God, all things are possible. Isn't that something? Jesus was a man who lived and was led by this Holy Spirit. He lived in the Holy Spirit. He was led by the Holy Spirit, and he released the power of the Holy Spirit through his body. You know, kind of reminds me, just for a picture, of what David said in Psalm 23. David said, because he was king, he says, "The Lord anoints my head with oil." And the oil represented the fact that God had chosen him, and it represented the fact that God's favor was upon him. So David said, the Lord anoints my head with oil, but he anoints me to such a degree that my cup, whether that cup was his body or whether that cup was something that he had in his hand, the oil flowed down in such abundance that it ran into his cup and his cup overflowed. Huh? The blessing of God, the favor of God, the anointing of God is designed not just to be contained by you, but it's designed to flow out of you. Sort of like what Jesus said in John the 7th chapter. I believe I spoke on this last week. In John the 7th chapter, Jesus said to his disciples, he said, "Out of your innermost being shall flow rivers of living water, rivers of life, rivers of healing when you receive the Holy Spirit." As a matter of fact, in Acts chapter 1, Jesus tells his disciples, he says, "I'm about to ascend to the Father. I'm about to sit at his right hand. But listen, I don't want you to go anywhere. I don't want you to go anywhere until you have received the promised Holy Spirit, because you can't do ministry without him." That's what he was saying. And they started talking about, "Lord, when will you restore the kingdom to Israel?" and all of that kind of thing. Jesus said, "Don't you worry about that." He says, "But you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you." This is what we see in the life of Jesus. And we're told in the New Testament, we're told in Romans 8, that the same Spirit now who raised Jesus from the dead, the same Spirit that lived in Jesus, the same Spirit that healed that woman who touched the edge of his garment and he felt power flow out of him, the same Spirit that healed this paralyzed man, I want you to conceptualize this. I want you to receive this. Romans the 8th chapter says the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is the same spirit that lives in you. When we, as God's people, when we take the Lord with us, when we go to people who are hurting, and we in a very real sense bring Jesus into their midst, we have the kind of faith that these men had, that the woman with issue of blood had, that woman, if we have that same kind of faith that Jesus is more than willing and Jesus is more than able to touch the lives of those around us, we will find that with God, with the Lord, all things are possible. Amen. Listen, the doors of the church are open, and that's just another way of saying that if you want to join this church, you can do that. You can contact us, and you can let us know that you want to be a part of this church family. The numbers are 205-321-1136 or 205-321-1137. If you have been blessed by this broadcast, blessed by the sermons, blessed by the word of God that has been preached, if you're out there and you've been blessed by the ministries of this church, I want to encourage you to become a part of us. Now, if you have never given your life to the Lord Jesus, the one who can heal us of all of our sickness, of all of our diseases. I know that we got this COVID-19 virus going on all around us, but if you have never given your life to the Lord Jesus, I want to encourage you to do that right now. I want to encourage you, and I want you to know that our Lord is able, and how about this, he's more than willing to bring you out of a situation in which you have been injured. If you are willing to do that right now, pray this prayer after me. Father, I thank you for your son, Jesus. I thank you, Lord, that because of his ministry, he has given me the opportunity to be right with you. He has given me the opportunity to have all of the burdens of my sin taken away. And Lord, I seize that right now. And I ask Jesus to come into my life. I thank you, Lord, for receiving me now as your child. I thank you, Lord, for coming to live in me through the Spirit of Christ. I thank you, Lord, for receiving me into your kingdom. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer, my brother or my sister, I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to step out on faith. I want to encourage you to join church family. And if we've been blessed, if you were blessed by this message and you've been blessed by the ministry of this church, join this church family. So you need to join a church family. You need to become a part of the ministries of the church so that you can understand what God has for you and what God has promised to you in his word. And our God is not a man that he should lie. Our God is a God of truth. And what he has promised, if you are determined to have it, you will receive. God bless you. God bless you. This is the word of the Lord for the people of the Lord. Thanks be to the Lord. Amen. This is the first Sunday in December, and we typically celebrate the Lord's Supper on the first Sunday. And we remember the sacrifice of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The bread that we eat symbolizes his broken body. The wine we drink symbolizes his shed blood. As we eat and we drink this day, we become new creatures in his sight. Let's participate in this ceremony together. When the eve had come, he sat down with the 12. And he said, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, one of you will betray me." And they were exceedingly sorrowful, and they said, "Lord, is it I?" Then he took the bread, he blessed it and broke it. He said, "Take, eat, for this is my body." And then he took the cup and he gave thanks and he said, "Drink all of it. For this is my blood, which is shed for many for the forgiveness of sins." He said, "But we will not drink of this fruit of the vine with you again. I will not drink of this fruit of the vine with you again until I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." And when he had sung a hymn, he went out into the Mount of Olives. We can't go out into the Mount of Olives today, but we can go out to the highways and byways of Birmingham, and we can let others know that Jesus lives. And I want to encourage you that because he lives on the inside of you, why don't you take him to someone who needs him? Brothers, God bless you. I love you. And until we meet again, until we see each other again, unto him, now unto him who is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless before his throne with exceeding joy. Unto the only wise God be power, majesty, and dominion now, henceforth, and forever. Let the church say aloud, amen, in our home. God bless you, and we'll see you next week.